they're happy about that, I'm sure. So we're all going to start by singing together. Take a songbook, number 405. A friend I have called Jesus, it's just like his great love. Let's stand together to sing it. Brother Bob leads.
A friend I have called Jesus.
Great singing this evening, and we're excited about tonight. Good to have the tour group with us, and this is their final service, and they've been going since early May. I think the preacher said like something like 10 weeks and 50-some churches, and we get to be the grand finale. The best part of fireworks is the grand finale. The best service is the grand finale, all right? And looking forward to a great time with them tonight. They're going to come and sing for us right after the opening prayer, all right? Let's bow together, shall we? Father, we thank you for the privilege again to be here this evening. Thank you, Lord, for this morning and for meeting with us and for decisions that were made for you today. And Father, thank you for bringing the group here safely to us. Lord, we pause here at the beginning of the service to ask your hand of blessing to be upon all that's said and done here tonight. Lord, settle upon this place in an unusual way. Anoint the singers, anoint the preacher tonight, anoint those of us who will listen, that your will would be done in each and every life. Lord, may you be pleased this evening with what goes on in this place. May Christ be exalted, and we'll thank you for it. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
By the marvelous, glorious blood of Calvary, all washed away, every stain was covered by his grace. And since that day, all the chains of sin that did surround me, they all fell away. When I called on his name, oh praise the Lord, my soul was saved, my dead was buried.
Good evening, everyone. We're the Grace and Truth Trio from Hyles Anderson College. My name is Laura Barnes, and I'm a 2015 graduate from Crown Point, Indiana. and my debt was paid in March of 2005.
Hello everyone, my name is Liz Pounds. I'm from Hobart, Indiana. I will be a sophomore in the fall, and my debt was paid on a Thursday night in 2003.
Hello, my name is Cassandra Rivera. I'm from Maryville, Indiana, and in the fall I will be a sophomore. My debt was paid on September 16, 2014. And at the piano is Susanna Martin, all the way from Monterey, Mexico, and she'll be a junior in the fall. And her debt was paid on a New Year's Eve when she was 9 years old.
Born and unforgiven, locked in my own prison, until I heard that Jesus held the key. And through his loving mercy, although I was unworthy, his nail-scarred hands reached down and rescued me. My debt was paid by the marvelous, glorious blood of Calvary. All washed away, every stain was covered by his grace. And since that day, all the chains of sin that did surround me, they all fell away. When I called on his name, all praise the Lord, my soul was saved. My debt was paid. When the past reminds me of a life I left behind me, and Satan tries to rob me of my peace, that's when I remember the day I was delivered. My soul sings hallelujah, I'm redeemed. My debt was paid by the marvelous, glorious blood of Calvary. All washed away, every stain was covered by his grace. And since that day, all the chains of sin that did surround me, they all fell away. When I called on his name, all praise the Lord, my soul was saved. My debt was paid. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. My debt was paid by the marvelous, glorious blood of Calvary. All washed away, every stain was covered by his grace. And since that day, all the chains of sin that did surround me, they all fell away. When I called on his name, all praise the Lord, my soul was saved. They all fell away. When I called on his name, they all fell away. When I called on his name, all praise the Lord, my soul is saved. My debt was paid. You're the Word of God the Father from before the world began. Every star and every planet has been fashioned by your hand. All creation holds together by the power of your voice. Let the skies declare your glory. Let the land and seas rejoice. You're the author of creation. You're the Lord of every man. And your cry of love rings out across the lands.
Yet you left the gaze of angels, came to seek and save the lost,
and exchange the joy of heaven for the anguish of the cross.
With a prayer you fed the hungry, with your word you calmed the sea. Yet how silently you suffered that the guilty may go free. You're the author of creation. You're the Lord of every man. And your cry of love rings out across the lands. With a shout, you rose victorious.
victorious, wresting victory from the grave, and ascended into heaven, leading captives in your way. Now you stand before the Father, interceding for your own. From each tribe and tongue and nation, you are leading sinners home.
You're the
author of creation. You're the Lord of every man. And your cry of love rings out across the lands.
And your cry of love,
and your cry of love rings out across the lands.
My heart can be so troubled,
trembling with fear,
eyes closed tight, expecting
to overflow with tears.
If I could manage to whisper the name above all
names,
suddenly I am at peace, and things aren't quite the same.
It happens every time I speak his name. My spirit calms within me. I feel him ease a pain. It's a mystery, I agree. I never could explain.
But it happens every time I speak his name. Why is it we seek comfort from everyone but him, when hurts and failures leave us lonely and condemned? Oh, for the sound of Jesus' name to soothe and gently mend. Let the broken hear the name that makes things new again. It happens every time I speak his name. My spirit calms within me. I feel him ease a pain. It's a mystery, I agree. I never could explain. But it happens every time I speak his name. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
There's just something about that name.
It happens every time I speak the name of Jesus.
My spirit calms within me. I feel him ease a pain. It's a mystery, I agree. I never could explain.
But it happens every time I speak his name. Oh, it happens every time I speak his name.
I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the lily of the valley. Let's turn to 333. 333. Let's sing that first. Let's sing the first and last together. On the first, I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him light and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here, while I live by faith and do his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna, he my hungry soul shall fill. Then sweeping up to glory to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. Hallelujah, he's a lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Some announcements for us now. Listen carefully. Right after the service, everyone's welcome to stay, have some ice cream with us, and I think some hot dogs and some cold drinks, and it's going to be a good time of fellowship. And they got the volleyball net going to be set up, and you can you want to show your prowess on the volleyball court, you can do that. And we'll have a good time getting to fellowship with the ladies here and Brother Barnes. And so plan on staying tonight and enjoying some refreshment with us. The best part about it, it's free, okay? And just stay and enjoy that this evening. Then we're ready for VBS this week, Vacation Bible School, Monday through Thursday night, 6:30 each night. Workers, make sure you're here around 6 and ready to go, ready to receive the children as they come. And we're praying for a great week at VBS. Remember, Wednesday night, what time? 6:30 Wednesday night, okay? So be here at 6:30 for Wednesday evening this week because of VBS. And then, again, if you're going to, if you would help in some way, and if you just want to see what is needed as far as help for Lisa's shower on Saturday, Rachel would love to talk to you. And so please see her after the service and give her a hand with that. I know she'll appreciate that. That's this Saturday at 1 o'clock for Lisa's shower. Haven't heard anything yet, just that she's very uncomfortable. And I wanted to say that's good, but how do you say that's good if they're uncomfortable? But it's pray for Lisa and pray for Brett and Lisa and that all will go well and that that Ezekiel will show up soon, all right? And appreciate you doing that. Well, we want to welcome our guests that are here this evening. Anybody here tonight for the very first time, we'd love to meet you, find out who you are and where you're from. If you're visiting tonight, would you just put your hand in the air for us? We can see who you are and we'll try and meet you, find out who you are and where you're from. Anyone like that? Emma, do you have somebody with you you want to introduce or not? Emma Abrams. She's been here before. Do I know her? I'm sorry? Tina Nash. All right, Tina. Good to see you tonight. Thank you for coming. And how about these ladies on the back row? You're shaking your head at me. Okay. Tell me who you are and where you're from. Wonderful. Okay, great, great. Did you come to hear the girls sing tonight? Huh? You know one of these girls? You got a niece up here. There you go. All right, there's the connection. Good, good to have you. All right. Brianna has... Jasmine and Nicholas. Very good. Live a few houses down from us on the street there. It's good to have you guys here. They're going to be coming to Bible school this week. That's great. Thanks for coming to church on Sunday night. Very good. Ladies, good to have you tonight. Thanks for coming up and hearing the group sing. That's wonderful. All right. If you'll take just a moment and fill out the visitor card, we appreciate you doing that. In a little bit, we have an offering, and you just take a minute and drop that card in the plate when it goes by, and we'll have a record of your visit with us this evening. And you keep the pen as our gift to you for coming tonight. We're glad you're here. Let's give all the visitors a warm welcome, shall we? All right, let's do this. Brother Bob, pull that screen down. Brother Barnes says he has a, there's a promotional video. Do you want to come say a few words about it, or you just want to run it? What do you want to do? You want to come up and wax eloquent for a minute or two and let us know what's going on, and we'll get the screen, everything ready for you, okay, Brother Barnes?
Well, while they're getting that set up, I want to say thank you for having us tonight. We're excited to be here, and we've been looking forward to this for sure, and we've got some relatives in the back there of one of the girls, and so this is a good service. We're excited. Hyles Anderson's been around since 1972, and so that means this fall we'll be opening our doors for our 45th year, and we're super excited about all that God's done. The video we have will show a little bit of, and tell a little bit more about that and give some more of the numbers, but we're just excited about what God's been able to do through our students from students past who have graduated and gone out and served the Lord, and then also the students who are there presently who are serving while they're in college. There are many great Bible colleges, and I am for all of them. I wish we had more young people in Bible college. As far as the bottom line, we need every one of them. But one thing our college has really tried to do to set ourselves apart and to take a step above is to focus on ministry and training young people to work in the ministry. Now, not everybody who comes through our doors is going to be a full-time employee of a church. Some may never serve in that capacity, but all of us are a full-time Christian. And so I believe we should all be involved in ministering and being very involved in helping people. And so that's what our college emphasis is all about, teaching young people, yes, in the classroom, of course, but also teaching them on the weekends in the Chicagoland area how to help people and how to minister, how to bring people to church, how to win souls, and those things. And we'll play the video and let that tell a whole lot more than I could.
Since 1972, over 35,000 students have chosen Hyles Anderson College for their ministry training, with graduates serving the Lord in 55 foreign countries. In all 50 states, and in over 1,800 U.S. cities, Hyles Anderson College has a rich heritage of training some of the world's most effective Christian leaders. So, why should you choose Hyles Anderson College? At HAC, we are dedicated to preparing today's young people to be tomorrow's Christian leaders. With five academic programs and dozens of majors for you to choose from, you will receive the training and experience necessary to make an impact in this world for Christ. Our faculty combines modern teaching methods with old-fashioned Bible truths and fundamental Baptist distinctives to produce a well-rounded servant leader. At Hyles Anderson College, you will encounter professors who desire to help you reach your personal goals. These teachers are not only experts in their field, but also solid Christian examples and lead the way both academically and spiritually. Chapel sets the tone on the Hyles Anderson campus. You will get to listen to and interact with some of the most influential Christian leaders in the world. Powerful Bible preaching and uplifting music foster a spirit in the Hyles Anderson Chapel service that is simply unparalleled.
This is his chance to answer a very specific question. Who art thou, my son? Oh, that the Holy Spirit would ask all of us that question this morning. Who art thou? My son?
Lives are changed, decisions are made, and hearts are encouraged every single day. Your social life can be as exciting or as quiet as you choose. The Office of Student Life and the Activities Department partner together to provide you many opportunities to have fun or just relax. Off-campus activities vary in size, style, and content. You can go along with a small group of dating couples on a chaperoned activity for a quiet dinner at a local restaurant, or with several hundred students to enjoy the Indiana Dunes National Lakeshore. Activities into Chicago include world-class shopping, restaurants, museums, zoos, professional sporting events, and the annual Christmas lights activity. There are many things on campus to keep you occupied during free time as well. The Student Recreation Center houses ping pong tables, air hockey, pool, foosball, board games, and televised sporting events. The Square, our on-campus restaurant, the bookshelf, as well as the coffee shop, provide a place to relax, unwind with friends, or just simply read a book. The Highlander Athletics Department contributes a great opportunity for you to compete in a variety of intramural sports. Hyles Anderson College is home to a full gymnasium with a weightlifting room, fitness center, basketball and volleyball facilities, as well as locker rooms. Championship games in volleyball, soccer, and basketball are attended by the entire student body and are highlights of each school year. While at Hyles Anderson, First Baptist Church of Hammond will be your main classroom. It is here that your training is made practical as you'll help to reach a lost world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is here that you will hear uplifting music and spirit-filled preaching that will change your life forever. While being loved and taught by the great people of the First Baptist Church of Hammond, we believe that you don't have to wait until you graduate to be in the ministry. You can be in the ministry while you're training for the ministry. What is taught in the classroom Monday through Friday is put into practice on the weekends in the Chicagoland area. Weekly soul winning and discipleship will be an integral part of your life at Hyles Anderson College. You are encouraged to join one of the many outreach ministries made available by the First Baptist Church of Hammond. Hyles Anderson College is located in Lake County of Northwest Indiana. The 107-acre campus includes wooded hills overlooking a 4-acre lake, a spacious gymnasium, athletic fields, a dining facility, the Wendell Evans Auditorium, and a main building complex attached to the residence halls by lighted and heated hallways. The HAC campus is situated in a suburban area, yet it is less than a 1-hour drive from downtown Chicago. So, what about you? Are you serious about serving God with your life? Are you eager to make an impact in this world for Christ? Are you ready to join the family of thousands of HAC graduates all over the world? Well, we're ready to help. Let's get the process started today. Visit our website or call for more information. Hyles Anderson College is prepared to help you get from where you are today to where you want to be, doing what God wants you to do.
Boy, that's good. That's good. Makes me want to go to college all over again. And amen. That was great. Didn't have half that stuff when I was there, I'll tell you that much. And great, great. Hey, girls, come on back. Let's sing another few songs for us, would you please? Thank you.
We read downtrodden believer. I know the burden reliever. He is the sinless redeemer. He's my best friend. I met him on bended knee. He met me at Calvary. Underneath the old rugged tree, that's where I've been.
Now he dries every tear I cry. He answers when I ask why. He's every single little thing I need. He's been faithful down to the end. He's closer than a brother's been. When I think about all he is, that's all I need.
Christian, don't give up trying. Mountains were made for climbing. The one who walks beside me will stand by you. I've never known him to fail. He's conquered both death and hell. So do not doubt that he will prevail.
I've seen what he can do. Now he dries every tear I cry. He answers when I ask why. He's every single little thing I need. He's been faithful down to the end. He's closer than a brother's been. When I think about all he is, that's all I need. Now he dries every tear I cry. He answers when I ask why. He's every single little thing I need. He's been faithful down to the end. He's closer than a brother's been. When I think about all he is, that's all I need. When I think about all he is,
lately I've been through some testing and trials. Felt like a detour that went on for miles. But standing here now, looking back, I can say, Lord, I'm thankful. would never survive. But here I am feeling so strong and alive. The darkness is past and the morning is bright, and I'm thankful.
Lord, I'm thankful like David after Goliath, like Paul and Silas after the jail. I'm thankful like Daniel after the lions. Lord, I'm thankful. Thankful like Noah back on dry ground. Thankful like Lazarus finally unwound.
Every beat of my heart wants to pound. I'm thankful.
Lord, I'm thankful.
Unclear, but all along, Lord, you were hovering near, and I'm thankful. All of my sins were a thundering roar that echoed the guilt that I could not ignore, but it's nailed to the cross, and I hear it no more, and I'm thankful.
Lord, I'm thankful like David after Goliath, like Paul and Silas after the jail. I'm thankful like Daniel after the lions. Lord, I'm thankful. Thankful like Noah back on dry ground. Thankful like Lazarus finally unwound.
Every beat of my heart wants to pound. I'm thankful.
Lord, I'm thankful.
Lord, I'm thankful like David after Goliath, like Paul and Silas after the jail. I'm thankful like Daniel after the lions. Lord, I'm thankful.
Thankful like Noah back on dry ground. Thankful like Lazarus finally unwound.
Every beat of my heart wants to pound. I'm thankful.
Lord, I'm thankful. I'm thankful. Lord, I'm thankful.
My longing for love wouldn't go away. I was desperate, searching, bound by pain, looking for answers, but nothing seemed right. Where was my answer? What was my life? Blinded by sin, I was lost, couldn't see, until I turned my eyes to Calvary. Oh, the cross where Jesus died, shed his blood, gave his life for you and I. My sins erased, no longer lost. My debt was paid, I am saved. Oh, the cross. As I live my life, I find heartache, trouble, battles to fight when fear tries to grip me and I feel alone.
Jesus is with me, I'm not on my own.
Now
changed because of Calvary. Oh, the cross where Jesus died, shed his blood, gave his life for you and I. My sins erased, no longer lost. My debt was paid, I am saved.
Oh, the cross.
Can't beat that. 523, let's sing together. Let's all stand as we sing. I sought a flag to follow, a cause for which to stand. 523, let's sing that first together.
I sought a flag to follow, a cause for which to stand. I sought a valiant leader who could my love command. I sought a stirring challenge, some noble work to try, to give my life fulfillment, my dreams to satisfy. I found them all in Jesus, the life, the truth, the way.
Amen. Great one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. Pianists will play a few stanzas, and we'll come back and sing that last together. Thank you.
found them all in Jesus, the life, the truth, the way. Beneath his flag I'll take my stand and follow him today. Let's sing that last together. I sought for satisfaction, for yearning deep within. As you find your seats, let's sing that last. I sought for satisfaction, for yearning deep within. I sought for full deliverance from chains of guilt and sin. I sought for peace and pardon, for freedom from my fears. I sought a hope to cling to beyond these passing years. I found them all in Jesus, the life, the truth, the way. Beneath his flag I'll take my stand and follow him today.
Everybody said? Amen. Good singing. You can be seated. Going to take the offering tonight. If you want to give something especially for the group, Brother Taylor, would you grab those envelopes back there? And if you need an envelope to put in there, just put Hyles Anderson on it, or Hyles or Anderson or Barnes or something like that, and they'll make sure that they'll get that. If anybody wants to do that, stick your hand up. Don will give you an envelope, and that way you can give towards it. If any of you ever travel, you know that's not cheap to travel, and we want to be a blessing to them. And they don't ask for anything when they come. They don't say we have to have so much money. And Brother Barnes did, but the group didn't. And no, I'm kidding. But they don't make anything like that. It just come on a love offering basis, and we want to be good to them, okay? So let's pray and ask God's blessing on offering tonight. Brother Andy, lead us in our prayer, would you please?
Let's pray. Father, thank you for another opportunity to be in your house tonight. Lord, thank you for the great uplifting music we've heard so far that's been honoring to you. Lord, as we come to the offering, we just pray that you bless each gift and giver alike. And Father, just help us to realize that we're giving to your kingdom, Father, and help us to be sacrificial and cheerful in our giving, Father. Open our hearts for the preaching of the Word of God next, and we'll thank you for it. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Well, we're going to have a special, and then Brother Barnes is going to preach to us tonight. Brother Barnes teaches media classes and graphic design at Hyles Anderson College, and as you heard, he and his wife are fairly recent graduates of the college, and he was, upon graduation, given the Highlander Award, which is presented by the administration, the faculty, and the staff to the male student that most exemplifies the biblical and spiritual values that they're trying to teach at the college. So this is a fine young man, and we're looking forward to him giving to us what the Lord has given him. And he'll come to preach right after the ladies sing.
Christians all around the world have known whom they believe. They served God and surrendered all to serve Him faithfully. But there are those who've watered down the truths that they once preached about. How can we sit idly by? We must keep the standard high. Truth and right, one who'll go unto the lost and tell them of His light. Few have answered to His call, and fewer still have stayed. Christians, it is time to rise, the name of God proclaim.
Song my wife wrote about a year and a half ago, and it's become one of my favorite songs for sure. I'm sorry, this isn't on yet. He's looking at me like, is something right? All right, here we go. All right, now I think I'm on.
check this thing. There we go. This is a very large lapel mic, I'm just saying. It's about as big as the knot of my tie. But it works. That's what matters. Well, thank you so much for having us. We are excited to be here. It's been a phenomenal summer. God's been so good to us. Just simply for the fact of keeping us safe as we travel. If that's all we had, then we've been super blessed. We even passed a few accidents and seen the coroner's van in a few cases and just some sad things. But God's kept us safe, and we're thankful for that. God has kept me sane, traveling for 9 weeks with 4 women. I didn't know if I could do it. But God was there through the hard times. No, God's been really good in that regard for sure. I'm a huge sports fan, and I love to follow sports. And so there's been a lot happening, especially if you follow any sports in the NBA and a lot of things like that. And so I get excited about something. I get an alert on my phone, and I turn around to tell someone, and there's absolutely no one to tell. They don't care. It doesn't matter. And even if I did tell them, they're like, oh, awesome. You know, they're back to what they're doing. But we've had a good time nonetheless. It's been a new experience for me. I traveled for 3 summers as a student. I traveled singing bass with a quartet, and so obviously all guys. So we have some free time. We go to a parking lot and we throw a football around. But for the girls, we go play volleyball. And there's many differences, and we've had a good time. And they have taught me things. Taught me when to keep my mouth closed and just mind my own business. But it's been a wonderful experience, and it's been a great summer. And it's always exciting when you get to your last church. You look back at all the great memories, and I'm glad that we get to experience that with you. Thank you for letting us do that. And girls are great. John chapter number 5, if you will. John chapter number 5. I think I pulled that too far. There we go. All right. Let's see if I can get my notes out here. Once my notes come out here, we'll be good. I've been preaching off an iPad this summer. Interesting experience, different, you know. In Bible college, we always use, you know, printed out notes every time, you know, and all that. It's been really good, except for the last church I was at, my iPad was dead. And so it was an interesting sermon, but I finally got it open, so that's good. John chapter number 5, we'll jump right in here. Read the first 9 verses, and then we'll pray, and then we'll jump in. John chapter number 5, verse 1. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having 5 porches. In these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first, after the troubling of the water, stepped in, was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. And a certain man was there which had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he saith unto him, Wilt thou be made whole? The impotent man answered him, Sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool. But while I am coming, another steppeth down before me. Jesus saith unto him, Rise, take up thy bed, and walk. And immediately the man was made whole, and took up his bed and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. Let's go to the throne in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for your word. And I thank you that we have these wonderful stories that we can take and draw truths from and apply to our lives. And so I ask tonight that you'd help me to do just that. Guide my words and please hide me behind you and let it be you speaking tonight. And that way someone can be changed. And please give us something we can apply and be better for. I just ask that you'll do that tonight. We ask these things in your son's name. Amen. Got an awesome story here. This has been one of my favorite stories to share in preaching on tour, and I've been the tour preacher as far as responsibility for the past 5 weeks of our 9 total on the road, and before that my wife was the preacher. But I'm just kidding. That was just to see if you're awake. Half of you are already gone. we had one of our senior staff members was with us, and he was doing the preaching. But this has been the sermon I've preached the most in those last 5 weeks, and that's because this story is very exciting to me. It means a lot, and I think there's a few reasons why. But we'll jump in and we'll look through this story, and then we'll pull a few things out of it at the end that hopefully we can apply and help ourselves with. We see here Jesus comes to Jerusalem, and he's coming. This is very early in his earthly ministry, so he's just getting started here, and he's coming into Jerusalem, and he comes to this area called Bethesda, and it's an area where a kind of large pool or a body of water, could have been a lake that was there or something, but what we do know is there are five different porches that are around this pool, and they must be very large because in verse 3 it says there's a great multitude of impotent folk that are on these porches. And so we have these five very large areas filled with people who are ill. Some of them are diseased. Some of them are crippled to an extent. But we have a lot of very sickly people on these five porches. And Jesus comes into this area, and I can see him coming in, and if you'll use your imagination with me, he's walking in there, and he's got his disciples with him. And I'm sure the reactions were different. I think of Thomas often and how he was always labeled as the doubter. And I don't know if he walked in and said, man, I don't know, Jesus. I don't know if we can help all these people. There's a lot. Or perhaps Luke, who was a physician, is walking in and he sees all these people who need help. And his heart goes out to him. And he feels, man, I can help these people. They need some help. Or perhaps there was Peter, who was always the impetuous one. And probably my favorite disciple to read about. All the great stories are from Peter, you know. I've been told this, if Jesus was writing memos like a staff would, Peter would get all the memos. It was everything, you know. Peter, we don't cuss at people. Peter, we don't fish naked. We don't do any of that. You know, all these things, Peter would have got all the memos. Peter was the wild one. And he's probably my favorite to read the stories about. I can just see Peter as he's walking in there. He's probably asking Jesus, come on, let me heal him. I'll heal all of them. Come on. And so I can just see him all excited about it. And as they're coming in, though, Jesus meets this man that had been diseased a very long time. It said he'd had this infirmity 38 years. Now, we don't have a whole lot of direction on that. We don't know if this was something he's had from birth, and perhaps he's 38 years old, and so he was born like this. We don't know. It could have been something that was because of an injury. What we do know is it had something to do with his ability to walk, because later on in verse 8, he receives that healing, and he's then able to walk. So this infirmity that he's had for 38 years has something to do with his walking ability. So perhaps a partial paralysis or even more so, we don't really exactly know. But what we do know is this. He's had this for a very long time. It's been 38 years. And he's been at the pool for a very long time as well, as Jesus says in verse number 6, I believe. Yes, that he'd been now a long time in that case. So this man has been by the pool for a very long time, and he has not been able to walk in a very long time. So he's there, and Jesus asks him a very interesting question. He says, wilt thou be made whole? Now, one would think that the answer would be obvious. Of course I would want to be made whole. But since Jesus asked the question, I think the question was begging to be asked. So it points out to me that there are some people who are not wanting to be made whole. Now, they may have had a casual desire, and yeah, it'd be great if I was healed. But they didn't want to be made whole. But this man, we see, really wanted. When Jesus asked him, wilt thou be made whole? He answers, sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool. But while I am coming, another steppeth down before me. So this man, even though he can't walk, he can't move like he should, every time the angel came down, he was still trying to get to the pool. He said to Jesus, while I'm coming, I am working to my best. So I would imagine he'd be crawling to an extent and dragging himself towards the pool, but someone would come down before him every time. So in answer to Jesus' question, wilt thou be made whole? He said, yes, I would love to be. I just have no one to carry me to get there. And I just can't do it. He's had this for a very long time, and he's been waiting, but he's also been working and trying to be healed. He wanted healing. And of course, we know the story. He says, I don't have anybody to get me there. And Jesus says, well, we'll skip that whole thing. Take up that bed and walk. And we see that the man, he jumps up, and right away, he's healed. And we have this wonderful story of healing. But how many people were there? Multitudes. We only have the story of one. Now, knowing Jesus and how we read of him in other passages and knowing the heart of God, I would imagine he went through and healed many other people that day. Anyone who is willing to receive healing, I would believe he would go through and heal them. But the man we have the story about, we have this man. And I think there's some interesting things about him and the way he reacted, the way people reacted to him, that we find in this story. And I see how it parallels to us in many cases. In verse 3, talking about the the impotent folk waiting for the moving of the water. Is that not us sometimes? Just waiting for God to work. We need that miracle in our life. We're just waiting for the moving of the water. It says there's the blind people. Perhaps you've lost your vision of what God can do. Perhaps you're struggling. You can't see the light at the end of the tunnel. You're looking for that miracle. Or the halt. Perhaps you feel like you can't quite do what you used to be able to do. You can't quite accomplish for God the things you used to be able to. Or the withered. And you feel like, I'm just a little burnt out. I've been doing this a long time, and God's been good. And I'll tell you that. I'll be the first to tell you, God's been good. But I just feel like I can't go on. Feel a little burnt out. And we're looking and we're waiting for the moving of the water. Looking for that miracle. We see here the making of a miracle and how Jesus reacted to that. And I find a few interesting things. Beginning in verse 8, Jesus saith unto him, Rise, take up thy bed and walk. And immediately the man was made whole and took up his bed and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. The Jews therefore said unto him that was cured, It is the Sabbath day. It's not lawful for thee to carry thy bed. He answered them, He that made me whole, the same said unto me, Take up thy bed and walk. Then asked they him, What man is that which said unto thee, Take up thy bed and walk? And he that was healed wist not who it was, for Jesus had conveyed himself away, a multitude being in that place. So we see here the Pharisees come and talk to him. They say, What are you doing? He's walking down the street carrying his bed, and they stop him. They say, Whoa, 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 whoa. What are you doing? You can't carry your bed. This is Sunday. This is Saturday. It's the Sabbath day. You can't carry your bed. That's against the rules. Now, the Pharisees, they were good people. They were. They lived good lives. Now, unfortunately, they lived an empty life because they were not living life through Jesus. They were living through their own abilities. And so these men, if they didn't correct that before they died and went to hell. So a very sad story for such good people, to be honest with you. They were good people. But these good men, I would imagine, if they've been doing their best to be the good citizen and the good example, they probably have been to the Pool of Bethesda before. Just as we would as a church go help out a homeless person or go to a rescue mission and help the people there. I would imagine these men would have done the same. And if they had, they've seen this man there before. He's been there a long time. And so now they see him walking. They know he can't walk, but he's walking and he's carrying his bed. And they're like, whoa, what are you doing? You can't carry your bed. And what happened was they entirely missed the miracle. Jesus did a miracle and he worked in this man's life and literally turned his life around. He now has the ability to walk. He can work a job. He can be supporting for his family. He can actually live a normal life. What a wonderful miracle, but the Pharisees missed it. Entirely missed it. Don't allow yourself to be in the same boat. Don't miss the miracles God works. Now, sometimes we get caught up with miracles and we feel like, well, God doesn't really work miracles today. It's just not the same. And I'll give you some of that. We don't have Jesus here in the flesh healing a person by touching them or speaking right there. So I understand. We don't feel like it's exactly the same. But let me tell you, God still works miracles. God is still definitely a miracle-working God. Very often we see a physical healing that the doctor said was impossible. That's a miracle. But so much more than the physical, when a person gets saved, that's a miracle. When a life that was gripped by sin and struggling in addiction is turned around, that's a miracle. God is still very much a miracle-working God, but don't be like the Pharisees and miss that miracle. Don't allow yourself to get caught up in the circumstances and miss the working of God. If someone walks an aisle and gets saved in church, sometimes we've all been guilty. We sit there and we get a judgmental spirit. We start to judge, and I can't believe they wear that to church, or I can't believe they'd say what I heard them saying earlier, or what they were listening to in their car on the way in, or what they were doing in the parking lot. And we miss God doing a miracle. Don't allow yourself to get caught up in that. Don't miss the miracle just like the Pharisees. And when a sinner gets saved and a life is changed, entirely missing it, don't allow yourself to be in that spot. Don't miss the miracle. But, as I said before, the Pharisees, they lived those good lives, but empty lives. They lived a life without salvation. More than missing the working of God around us, don't miss the working of God for you. Don't miss salvation. Don't allow yourself to go through life and to come to a wonderful church and to be faithful and helping out and serving and all these wonderful things. It's all great. But don't do it and not receive salvation. That is God's free gift. Every one of us should have that. God, in His grace, gave us the gift of salvation and the wonderful story of the cross. Don't miss out on salvation. Most of the time, though, in a church like this on a Sunday night, everybody, almost everybody is saved. A large majority is saved. So to you, to those that are saved tonight, I'll say this. You've not missed the miracle of salvation. Amen. Don't forget about it. Don't forget about what God did for you when He took you where you were in living a life of sin and He gave you hope. The world doesn't have hope, but we have hope because we have heaven. God is such an awesome God and gave us salvation. Amen for that. Don't ever forget it. If you ever need some motivation in life, think about the cross. Just take time to read through the passages and put yourself there and watch as Jesus is falsely accused and doesn't say a word. Let me tell you, if someone's falsely accusing me of something, I'm standing up for it. That's the way we are. But Jesus, knowing that if He did, we wouldn't have the cross, He went on anyway. And then they put Him in a room, and Roman soldiers, massive men who their entire life was dedicated to being as physically impressive as they could be, they took the time to beat Him in the face. And they'd say to Him as He was blindfolded, "Well, if you're really God, tell us who hit you." Of course He knew who hit Him. But He didn't say a word. They pulled the beard right out of His face, ripped it out. They took a crown of thorns and used a rod and beat it into His skull until the blood was rushing down. And of course, they took the cat of nine tails and they literally ripped the skin off His body. What historians will tell us was usually the end of the process. Normally, a person couldn't go through all of that and even make it to the cross. Not to mention go through all of that, then carry their own cross to where they were nailed to that cross. And as He's dropped in the ground, His bones pop out of joint. Pierce the skin in some cases. As He said, "My bones stare up at me." And He went through all of that for you. He went through every bit of that pain for you. Let me tell you, the cross didn't kill Jesus. Jesus gave His life for you. The Roman soldiers, as much as they tried, they couldn't take Him out. He gave His life for you. And then, of course, He rose again 3 days later, proving that He was still God, proving that He had conquered it all. And He did this whole thing just for you, just so you didn't have to spend eternity in hell, separated from God the Father. Don't miss it. Don't miss the miracle of salvation. Don't allow yourself to be there. You see, the Pharisees in this story, they missed out on the working of God. But ultimately, they missed out on the miracle of salvation. Don't allow yourself to be in that same boat. The story goes on, though. Verse number 14, we see, "Afterward, Jesus findeth him in the temple and said unto him, Behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more, lest the worst thing come unto thee. The man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus which had made him whole." So in verse 13, they'd asked him, "Who did this miracle? Where did this come from? How did this happen?" And he had no idea. He said, "I don't know. When I was able to stand up, I was so excited I could finally stand. I stood up." I would imagine he was probably jumping. And by the time he turns around to see and probably to say thank you, and he looks around and Jesus is gone. He had slid into the crowd and kind of gotten himself away. So the man had no idea. But when he meets Jesus in the temple, Jesus does not greet him and give him his name. He may have, and we just don't have it recorded. But I think it was a little different. Jesus greets him and says, "Behold, thou art made whole, sin no more, lest the worst thing come unto thee." This man had gone through the physical healing. But because Jesus said unto him, "Behold, thou art made whole," I think it was more than that. He knows he has the ability to walk. He walked there. He knows he's been healed. But God says to him, "Behold, thou art made whole, sin no more." It went beyond the physical healing, and this man received a spiritual healing. And because of that faith that he had, he received salvation. And then in verse 15, the man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus. Jesus didn't greet him by name. He didn't say, I'm Jesus, by the way. He may have. We don't have it recorded. I think it was because he knew, well, there's only one person that can give us salvation, and that would be Jesus and the Messiah. And he went around telling everybody, you know what, I've been made whole, and I know who it is now. It's Jesus. And we see the master of the miracle. And let me tell you, anytime there's a working that goes on in a church, anytime that a life is changed or someone is healed or a life is turned around, it is always because of Jesus. It is always pointing back to the master of the miracle. If we want to accomplish the miracles, if we want as a church to reach the lost and to see the church grow and lives are built up and families united, if we want that to happen, it's got to be because of the master. The master has to be the driving force behind everything in the church. And when he does, when he is, the miracles happen. So we see the master of the miracle. And to this man, at first he was doubting. He was doubting, I don't know how this miracle happened. I don't know. Then we see he meets the master a second time, receives salvation. Then he knows, there's no doubt in my mind who this was. This was Jesus. When the miracle happens, and we haven't missed it, then we notice the master of the miracle. And the doubt is erased. Doubt is a very common, really, I guess is a good word to use for it, a common thing. We all struggle with doubt. Every one of us are prone to doubt. That's where we are as a human, a frail human. The devil knows that, and he attacks us with that. You get to a point in you know what you believe, but you start to doubt what you believe, and the devil will push that, and he'll try to drive a wedge there. But let me tell you, God's not in the doubting. God's not giving us the spirit of fear. God doesn't want us to doubt. But we will all doubt at times. We see examples of that in the Bible. We see Thomas, a disciple yet always labeled the doubter. Why is that? Because when even Jesus had come back from the grave, he watched Jesus die, and still he had to physically touch the wounds to believe. He was doubting. Do I blame him? I don't think so. I'm a human as well. I doubt sometimes. But he's always labeled the doubter because of that moment. Thomas, this is a little bit of history, and so I can't back this up with the Bible, so you take it or leave it. Thomas, the Bible does refer to him as Didymus, and the meaning of that name is the twin. And so history will tell us that, obviously, because he's just referred to as the twin, the person he is, that he looks like, is obviously more important than him. Otherwise, he would be no more famous, and they would be referred to as the twin. They're just the twin, the lookalike. So historians will say that he most likely looked a lot like Jesus. That is a possible reason why Judas felt the need to kiss Jesus in the garden to tell them apart. Think about a man who literally looks like Jesus, but still doubts him. And if none of that is accurate, I think it has some serious backing. But if none of it's accurate, nonetheless, Thomas lived with Jesus for 3.5 years. Yet still he doubted. I see John the Baptist, who when he's about to lose his life, sends two of his disciples to ask Jesus, are you really the Messiah? This is the same John the Baptist who is related to Jesus. The same one who when he was in the womb and his mother was told Jesus is coming, the Bible says he leapt in the womb. God was working on him. He wasn't even a fully formed human. Yet still, he doubted. And probably the greatest contrast, he was the man who baptized Jesus. And as he baptizes him and brings him up out of the water, he experienced God. Everyone around him did. Both audibly and visibly. The Spirit of God descended like a dove. And he heard God speak, behold, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And he experienced all of this, and yet still, he doubted. What does that tell me? That tells me that we're all going to doubt. We're all going to have times where we struggle with doubt. Doubting what we believe, doubting what we do, doubting why we do it. The devil knows that, and he will attack us. And I say this often, you've got to know where the devil is going to attack and fight against it. The Bible compares the devil to a roaring lion. A roaring lion is not an animal of stealth. Now, a lion can perhaps be stealthy at times, but if he is roaring, there is no stealth anymore. If there is a roaring lion out by the volleyball net out there, guess where I'm not going to be? Playing volleyball. I will be, I'll send the tour girls out one at a time. Maybe he'll get full by the time I get out there. No, but seriously though, I'm gonna be the exact opposite direction, running like a little girl, screaming my head off. That's what the devil's compared to, a roaring lion. We ought to know when he's coming. Now, sometimes we're blinded by our own mistakes and sin, and we stumble even more. But all of us know areas that trip us up. You know areas that'll catch you up, and if you're not careful and if you don't walk guard around yourself, you'll end up falling into sin. All of us have those areas. The devil knows that. And one of those areas that everyone has is we all struggle with doubt. We will go through a time, if you have not, you will. You'll go through a time where you doubt. And Jesus says, we're not in the doubting. Our faith is what will pull us through there. God says, there are very few things in the Bible that God says are impossible. In fact, he says at one point, you know, that all things are possible. One thing he does say is that it's impossible to please him without faith. We have to have that faith, one, to please God, but two, to erase that doubt. Our faith is what will pull us through. Our faith in the master of the miracle. We see here for this man, he had no doubt in his mind who had worked this miracle because of his faith. His faith is what gave him salvation in verse 14, and his faith in verse 15 is what gave him the courage to go tell people what it was. We've got to have faith in the master of the miracle. But lastly, it will be done. Verse 16, and therefore did the Jews persecute Jesus and sought to slay him, because he had done these things on the Sabbath day. But Jesus answered them, my Father worketh hitherto, and I work. Therefore the Jews sought the more to kill him, because he not only had broken the Sabbath, but said also that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. We see here that Jesus said, well, now let me give you the message of the miracle, in that all of the glory must go to the Father. Jesus was the one who had been there, who talked to the man, who healed the man, who was there in the temple with him, he gave him salvation, who received the criticism, yet at the end of it he said, no, this is not about me. This is about the work of my Father. If the Son of God, and yea, God, as the Trinity, if he is giving the glory to the Father, I'm pretty sure we should be doing the same. When the miracle happens, when God does the work and we are on cloud nine and we're super excited about it and we're rejoicing in the triumph, we can't take any of the credit. It has all got to go to the Father. We see the message of the miracle. This whole thing happened because Jesus wanted to give glory to the work of the Father. As a church, you'll see good times, you'll see bad times as well. But you'll see God work and you'll see lives changed. You'll see big days where you have a great amount in attendance and great times of fellowship and wonderful things. But we as a church must give all the glory to God in everything. And if that is going to happen on a corporate level, that has got to happen on a personal level. If we're going to give God all the glory for the happenings around us, we've got to be doing the same in our personal life. Can't get caught up in what God has given you in abilities and talents and get caught up in that and not give God the glory. It's very, very easy for us as we travel and we're in so many places. These girls, they sing amazing, sing beautifully. It's very easy for us, and I get up and I get to preach and share God's word and talk to people. And we have a great time, and it's very easy to forget about that and to start soaking up some of the applause or the amens or the things like that, and to forget about the fact that this is all for God. That's what it's all about. That's why we do everything we do, and it's got to be always all for the glory of God. That is why pastor comes to work and he comes every day and he prepares a message for you and he preaches several times a week. That's why he does what he does. That's why the Sunday school teachers come and they rehearse their lessons and they share that with you and they pour their heart out. That's why the people who go out and pick people up and bring them into church, it's why they take their time and their energy and do that. It's why we do what we do, and it's all for the glory of the Father. If that ceases to be true, we're in trouble. If we stop getting to the point where we give God all the glory, that's when the miracles stop. For the miracle to work, for the life to be changed, I've got to give all the glory to the Father. And if I can do that, God does another miracle, and I give him the glory. And God does another miracle, and I give him the glory. And a sinner gets saved, and we give God the glory. And a life gets changed, and we give him the glory. A broken home is reunited, and we give him the glory. And story after story happens. And we look back years down the road, and we say, man, God's been so good. Praise the Lord. It's a cycle. And we see in this story an amazing miracle. A man whose life was empty, broken, incomplete perhaps. His life was entirely changed for the better. He went from a point of not being able to really move at all to being able to walk freely. And he went from a point of being spiritually hopeless to having a hope in heaven. An entire life was changed, and I would imagine many lives around him were changed because of the miracle. But we see people still who miss that miracle. We see the Pharisees and their blindness, and they're following rigidly the laws and living a good life, but missing out on the working of God. We also saw the driving force and the reason behind the entire miracle itself, the power that caused the miracle, and that was the Master. But at the end of the day, the miracle happened, a life was changed, and glory was given to the Father. I hope that'll be our testimony here. I hope God feels like he can come down and he can do a miracle because we're not missing it. We're doing everything we can through the Master, and we will give him all the glory for it. And I believe if we can get to that point, if we can get ourselves in line with that, that God will work the miracles. And as a church, so often we pray for weeks on end for a wayward saint to come back to the Lord, and we pray for an injured person to be healed, or someone who's struggling with a disease, and we pray for all these things. Let's make sure we're in the right spot for that. Make sure we're not missing the miracles that God is working, and we're doing everything we can through the power of Jesus. And we're giving God all the glory. And if we will, if we do as a church, I believe God will bless. You'll see the miracles happen. And he'll do, as the Bible says, he'll do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or even think. We serve a very awesome God. Let's give him all the glory for that. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the stories it holds and the lives that were changed then at that time, and the lives you'll change now if we'll just follow it. Lord, I ask you to help us to take this story to heart and to focus on you in all that we do. Please bless this church, God. Wonderful people. Please help them to give you all the glory for all your working. We ask these things in your name, preacher.
Keep your heads bowed just for a moment, if you would, please. I wonder if here tonight and the Lord spoke to your heart with the message this evening. Might be regarding salvation, for you to experience that miracle. It may be that it would be a life that's lived for God. Maybe he talked about you're weary, or maybe you just feel tired. You need to get a fresh touch from Jesus tonight, a fresh touch from him to keep on going and realize the miracle he's done in your life. And live a life out of gratitude to him and love for him. What a Savior. I wonder if the Lord has dealt with your heart tonight. And you say, Pastor, the Spirit of God stopped at my seat this evening. And he spoke to my heart in the message. Please pray for me this evening. Would you slip your hand up, Christian? Say, God, that's me. Yes. Amen. Amen. You may put them down. In a moment, we'll pray. We're going to have our invitation. The Lord has spoken to your heart. The altar's open for you to come and to do business with God. If you're here tonight and you've never received Christ as your Savior, you ought to come. We have people who have been trained. They'll take a Bible. They'll show you from the Bible how you can know you're on your way to heaven. If you're here tonight and you're saved and you've ever been scripturally baptized, you ought to come and say, I'm saved, but I'm not baptized. I want to be baptized and follow the Lord. Whatever it is that God has dealt with your heart about, why don't you respond to him this evening and do what he's telling you to do. Father in heaven, thank you for speaking to hearts tonight. I pray, God, now that you will help each individual to do what you're telling them to do in their heart. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for this, including this story tonight, for us to glean the truths that have been brought to us. Now, Father, help us to be obedient. May your will be done in every heart and life, and I'll thank you for it. Quietly, with your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob will sing. God has spoken to your heart. Respond to him this evening, will you?
Oh, soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Through death into life everlasting, he passed and we follow him there. Over us sin no more hath dominion, for more than conquerors we are. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. His word shall not fail you, he promised. Believe him and all will be well. Then go to a world that is dying, his perfect salvation to tell. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and
seated for a minute if you would, and you can go get the if you have children in the nursery, you can go get them, and let's free the nursery workers up and just tell them to come on up. We're glad to have Charles Bryant coming this evening. Charles came this morning, and this morning he received Christ as his Savior, and he's back tonight to follow the Lord in baptism, and so we're excited about that. And I think that you like Chuck, I hear, is that right? Okay, we're calling him Chuck. And this is exciting because today's his birthday. And so he's got a physical birthday and he's got a spiritual birthday on the same day. How about that? Isn't that great? July 10th. And also, it's David's birthday, David Norris. 21 today. How about that? And you got happy birthday? Can you know that one? You play happy birthday?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's sing happy birthday to these men. All right, ready? Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday, God bless you, happy birthday to you. Amen. That's great. Brother Bob, Brother Chuck, follow Brother Bob right downstairs, and he'll get you set up. We'll get ready to baptize him, and while we're preparing to baptize, I think, are the girls going to come sing? Okay, they're going to come sing a little bit more for you, all right? We'll be ready momentarily.
in a little town of Bethlehem so many years ago. They told him there was no room in the inn, but they had no way of knowing who they had turned away, the Lamb of God who would take away their sins. I'm glad I know who Jesus is. I'm glad I know who Jesus is. He's more than just a story. He is the King of glory. I'm glad I know who Jesus is.
So many people still today don't know who Jesus is. They've never felt his peace within their souls. But I want my life to show them how his love can set them free. He's the only one who can cleanse and make me whole. I'm glad I know who Jesus is. I'm glad I know who Jesus is. He's more than just a story. He is the King of glory. I'm glad I know who Jesus is. He's the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. He's the Counselor, Deliverer to me. He's the Everlasting Father. He is the King of glory. I'm glad I know who Jesus is. I'm glad I know who Jesus is. Show a little bit of love and kindness. Never go around with hatred's blindness. Take a little time to reach for joy and wear a happy face. Sing a little bit when the days are dreary. Give a little help to a friend that's weary. That's the way to make the world a happy place. Sing a song, spread some cheer. There are sad and lonely people everywhere. Be a friend, show some love. It will lift them from the dungeons of despair. Show a little bit of love and kindness. Never go around with hatred's blindness. Take a little time to reach for joy and wear a happy face. Sing a little bit when the days are dreary. Give a little help to a friend that's weary. That's the way to make the world a happy place. Offer help. Bring some hope to the fainting and discouraged on life's road. See a need. Crushed beneath life's load. Show a little bit of love and kindness. Never go around with hatred's blindness. Take a little time to reach for joy and wear a happy face. Sing a little bit when the days are dreary. Give a little help to a friend that's weary. That's a way to make the world a happy place. Show a little bit of love and kindness. Never go around with hatred's blindness. Take a little time to reach for joy and wear a happy face. Sing a little bit when the days are dreary. Give a little help to a friend that's weary. That's a way to make the world a happy place. That's a way to make the world a happy place.
Charles Bryant. And Charles, upon a public profession of your faith in Christ as your Savior, and in obedience to his command, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bearing the likeness of Jesus' death, and raised in the likeness of his resurrection. And the servant said, Master, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room.
Amen.
You.
here's one more, and then we'll.
My, what a joy to serve my Jesus. So glad that I could explain the way I feel. Rejoicing in unspeakable joy and full of glory. It's amazing, but praise God, I know it's real. When I received salvation, I felt such jubilation. For Jesus came and washed my sins away. He gives me strength and power to face the midnight hour. With all my heart and soul, I now can say, my, what a joy to serve my Jesus. So glad that I could explain the way I feel. Rejoicing in unspeakable joy and full of glory. It's amazing, but praise God, I know it's real. It's real. Now Jesus is my Savior. He gives me love and favor. He's my Redeemer, Master, Lord, and King. So when I tell my story, I give Him all the glory. He is my sword, my shield, my everything. My, what a joy to serve my Jesus. So glad that I could explain the way I feel. Rejoicing in unspeakable joy and full of glory. It's amazing, but praise God, I know it's real. It's amazing, but praise God, I know it's real. It's real. My.
Brother, did you get a chance to talk about your CD? You have CDs and stuff back there, don't you? You want to come and tell us about that just for a brief moment? Tell us what kind of deals you have going.
Sorry, I forgot to mention about it. We do have a table set up in the back, and we travel with about 12 different music CDs. Our college has been making, not CDs for many years, because it goes back before the CDs. We've been making a music album, can we say it like that? Since, I think, back to 1980 or so. And we sell a bunch of them online. We travel with 12 different ones with us. Now, I'll say this. We don't come to make sales. We don't come to get a love offering. We come because we want to be a blessing. I mean that. We also come because we want to represent our college and hopefully present that to young people and encourage them about Bible college. But one thing that does enable us to do that and help us afford it is the sale of our music CDs. That helps. We send four groups out every summer. We travel over 60,000 miles combined. We do a lot of traveling, a lot of expenses to get the groups ready to go and all that. And I think you know that. So one thing that helps us do that is by selling music CDs. And we do that because when you're buying something like that, it helps us financially, but it also helps you by getting good Christian music in your home. And I don't think you can ever get enough of it. So if you would stop by, we sell our CDs, one for $15 or two or more for 10 apiece. So if you buy two, it's 20, and three, it's 30, so on and so forth. And we'd love for you to at least stop by and take a look. But if not, if you don't have the money to buy something, that's fine. At least come by and say hi to us. We love meeting people, and that's the best part about traveling on tour, is meeting all of God's saints that are all over the country. And so please come talk to us. Come stop by. If you are in junior high or high school, please come talk to us about college. You need to be praying about that. Now, especially if you're in junior high, it's ways away, but you pray about it, and we'd love to get some information from you so we can stay in touch, and we'd love to be able to help with that. But please come by, talk to us, and we'll love to meet you. Rachel?
That's the kind of music you ought to have at home.
That's right.
That's what you want to listen to. Shut off the, what you call Christian radio, and get some good music to listen to.
Amen.
All right, and don't get me started on that. All right. Well, it's been a wonderful night, hasn't it? Are they set? Did my wife go over to help serve? Is that what you got the ladies together? Good. Okay, let's stand together. We'll have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you now for this evening. Thank you, Lord, for a wonderful, wonderful Lord's Day. Lord, I'm thankful for Charles and his faith in Christ. And Lord, I pray that your hand will be upon this young man and that he'll grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you for the singing group and for the good message tonight from your word. It sure has been good to be in the house of the Lord. Now, Father, we pray you'll bless our fellowship together this evening. Help us to enjoy the food that we'll partake of, and may the things we say be pleasing in your sight. So, Lord, dismiss us with your care. Make us mindful that you go with us from this place. Help us to do those things that are pleasing in your sight this week. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. Let's sing it together. Here we go. It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. It's a grand thing to follow Jesus anywhere and everywhere I go. For it's a grand thing to be a soldier in his army here below. It's the grandest thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. God bless you. We'll see you next door.